and welcome to The Future Report, a podcast hosted by social research company McCrindle for anyone curious about the future. My name is Ashley Phil, and each week I'll be sitting down with a guest to discuss a topic or trend that you need to know about.
There is a generation that comprises more than one in seven people. They're influencing the purchasing power of their household and they're key to the future, yet few people have heard of them. Within the next 4 years, they will outnumber the baby boomers and most of them will live to see the 22nd century. We're talking about Generation Alpha. Generation Alpha describes the current generation of children who began being born in the year 2010. They're mostly the children of Gen Y, who are also known as the millennials, who are now in their late 20s, 30s, and even their early 40s. By the time Generation Alpha have all finished being born, at the end of the year 2024, they will be the largest generation in the history of the world. They will live longer, work later into their life, and will be more formally educated than any generation before them. In today's episode of The Future Report, we're going to be talking about who Generation Alpha is, what their defining characteristics are, and how we can better understand them and their future. And to help me do that today is the person who coined the term Generation Alpha, who has co-authored a book with me on this exact topic, Mark McCrindle. Hey, Mark, how are you going?
Good, thanks, Ashley. Good to be with you.
Very exciting episode for us today to talk about Generation Alpha. And it was only a few months ago from when we're recording this podcast that we released a book that we co-authored called Generation Alpha, Understanding Our Children and Helping Them Thrive. And for those viewing this episode on YouTube, this is the book here, the book cover. We're really excited. And for anyone who's interested in obtaining a copy of that book, you can get a copy at all good bookstores and online as well. But Mark, it feels to me like people have really began to start sitting up and take notice of the fact that this generation is here, particularly over the last, I would say, 3 to 4 years. And the reason I think that is the case is because the oldest of this generation are starting to hit high school and they'll soon be entering their teen years. Do you agree with that? And why do you think people are starting to sit up more and take note that this generation's here?
Well, yes, that's right. They are taking note. And that's because, as you say, they're moving to the teenage years, but they are the children. And healthy societies always have a focus on their children, and rightly so. It was Nelson Mandela who said, "The keenest revelation of a society's soul is how it treats its children." And when we look at nations and how they're ranked, when you look at developmental indexes of societies, how the children are performing is always key to that. Everything from infant health to numeracy and literacy rates, educational outcomes, school completion, family dynamics and stability, all of those revolve around children. And that's what helps us see how nations are performing and where improvements are needed. So it's right that we focus on children, and Generation Alpha are today's children. And as you said, moving into that next very important stage of the teenager life stage, which is where so much change happens for them, but through them in a society. You know, so much social change and adaption, future of work and tertiary study, it all takes place through children, through teenagers as they move from the childhood years and transition then into the young adult and adult years. So, you know, it's a very crucial life stage for Gen Alphas. That's why the focus, but also because of these particular times that they are in. And clearly, the times are moving faster than ever. And a lot of us adults look at that and think, wow, what's it like for children growing up in this time? And not just growing up, but growing up digital in these times at a rate and with devices and platforms that have never existed for any other generation of children, and also the global nature of them as connected children, and also growing up through COVID, which has given a whole new lens, a whole new shaping for children in their formative years. So I think all of those factors have come together just in the last year and a half to suddenly get the world to focus on Generation Alpha, who are also, as you said, you know, the largest generation ever and the most globally connected generation ever, and the digital and the visual aspects of what is influencing them is huge. So, you know, a superlative generation in every way, and it's right that the world is suddenly taking note of Generation Alpha.
Absolutely. And you and I were only having a conversation about this recently, that what is formative years? And it's kind of often in brain development and developmental psychology that people talk about from 0 to 7. And then even though I think now that's, and what we were saying is that that has extended to the teen years and even to early adolescence and even your early 20s. So they're in those formative years and the context shaping them is just unlike anything we've seen before. So
yeah, totally. And they are so important, these years, and always have been. It was Aristotle who said, give me a child until he's 7 and I will show you the man. And, you know, 2 millennia of developmental psychology has just affirmed and shown what he knew to be the case, that not everything happens in childhood, but almost everything does in terms of setting us up for the rest of our life. So you know, understanding them and doing what we can to set them up for a future win in their lives really is critical.
Absolutely, it is. And I mean, I think it's pretty cool that you can lay claim, Mark, that you gave them their label. And for anyone who listened to our previous episode of the podcast about defining the different generations, we were talking about Douglas Copeland and how he gave name to Generation X and subsequently named the generations to come. You're kind of like the Douglas Copeland of the 21st century. And I think that's cool. And it's interesting when I share with people in my life or in presentations about how we came to name them Generation Alpha. And I was actually at the hairdresser a few months ago and talking about to my hairdresser who's got young kids in this generation about the fact that we just released a book on this topic and that you gave them their name. And without me giving the background of why, she was like, oh, that makes sense because my kids are always wanting to have their say, and kind of alluding to that alpha definition of being a dominant person or behavior. And I was like, that's not really what we meant by that name. So I feel like this is an opportunity for you, Mark, to set the record straight as to what you intended to communicate with that alpha label and why you chose to name them Generation Alpha and move to the Greek alphabet.
Oh, thanks, Ash. Well, it's an interesting issue, isn't it, naming a generation? And it certainly wasn't something that I had in my school magazine. My goal in life is to name a generation, if only. But it's a great honour to have been involved in this. And it was funny, you know, we read articles where people write about Generation Alpha, and one of them I read said, you know, to name a generation is a very lucrative thing. Well, that's ridiculous. No one has ever made a dollar by naming a generation, and nor should they. And nor should anyone make money by naming anything or for that matter, a child. In fact, it is a little bit like, as parents know, naming a child. It's a gift that you bestow on that child. It's a responsibility. And of course, it's an honor, but it's not who they are. It's an important part of their identity, but it's not the sum total of who they are. It's an indicator. It's an identifier, and it's helpful to that extent. But who they are will be developed over their time. That's why we spend a lot of time, you know, here researching baby names. And as you've written many of these baby names reports as we compile the top baby names, because it does tell us something about our society, the names we're choosing for our children. It is an important responsibility that parents have. It's the very first responsibility when they bring a child into this world is to have the honor of giving that child a name. But as we write in the book, you know, the name we give to a child or a generation is important, but it's not who they are. What matters far more than that is the name that they make for themselves. And so we wanted to choose a name for Generation Alpha, which was purely an identifier, a label, but not the sum total of who they would become. So we deliberately went to the scientific nomenclature using the Greek lettering, because that gives, if you like, an empty vessel into which Generation Alpha can create their own meaning for themselves, their own record in history, their own characteristics will be writ large through how they live the next 80 or 90 years of their life. And so we wanted to play a very small role in giving a language to describe them, but not fill that in with a description of them. And so the Greek alphabet is used much in science to name. In fact, you know, here we are in this COVID reality. The World Health Organization did well to quickly give a description, or if you like, a label, so that we could use it and not follow down the path we did prior of Spanish flu, that sort of thing. So coronavirus disease 2019, COVID-19. And in fact, here we are in the Delta strand, Remember, early on, it was called the Indian variant. And they said, well, that's ridiculous. I mean, it's right around the world. We don't even know if it actually originated in India, this strand. Call it the Delta variant, because we had the Alpha variant and the Beta variant. And so that's what we wanted to do with the generations as well. And we chose Alpha, you know, back in 2008, when I was doing research for my first book on the generations, the ABC of XYZ was that one. We recognized that actually, you know, Generation Z was about to be fully born, finishing up in 2009, and there was no label, no identifier for the generation to come from 2010. And so we ran a survey back then and asked the public, what do you think? That's what we like to do, as you know. And it was interesting to see the names that came back. And so many of the names, as we found in our generational analysis, are unhelpful because they're of the current era. And so people were saying, call them the onliners. No one talks about going online now, or the net generation. There was the dot-com kids that had been talked about for, you know, even the Gen Ys back in the day, and some people still wanted to use that. But they are now archaic phrases. And again, to give a label of a particular point in time the start of a generation is being born is not going to last a century. It's not helpful in that sense. And some people said, well, Generation A, because we went X, Y, Z, we're going back to the beginning. And I knew that that is not the communication we want here. We're not going back to the beginning. It's not history repeating itself. This is the start of a whole new reality, the first generation fully born in the 21st century. Let's give them a new start, maybe a new classification pathway. And so we picked up the Greek, and I said, you know, Generation Alpha, for those reasons discussed, and it seems to have stuck. And for those reasons, I said, I think it's useful because it'll allow the color and the fullness and the description and the meaning and the name that they make for themselves to flow on over the decades ahead.
Yeah, and we discussed this in, again, the last episode of the podcast, which was all about defining the generations and how they're named. And, yeah, that is absolutely what we believe. And as you just shared, Mark, around why we did choose a more objective scientific label like Alpha, moving to the Greek alphabet rather than something that is a bit more descriptive. And I've had people give their feedback to me on what they think maybe this generation should be called or what they could be called. And some people have said, do you think they should be named Generation COVID? Because COVID is and has and will be such a defining event for their life. And I'm like, I don't really know that that many people have a positive association with the virus. And I don't know that a generation would want to be labeled as Generation COVID. So I think many people are accepting of that alpha label for sure.
Well, exactly. And those mistakes, you know, labeling a generation based on what's happening then and there, we've shown in the past. Yeah, you mentioned Douglas Copeland, who named Generation X, of which, you know, I'm a part, because he sort of didn't want a label, the anti-label, you know, approach. The alternatives at the time, we think early 90s, we were being described as the MTV generation. I mean, is MTV even around, you know? Or we were called the slackers generation, because let's face it, what group of teenagers aren't slackers at times in their life? But a 50-something, you know, paying off a mortgage, raising children, Gen X, can't be described as a slacker anymore. So these point-in-time labels are unhelpful when they just pick up a particular historical reality at that moment in history. It's unhelpful. And the broader labeling, I think, is useful. And so Generation Alpha will probably lead to Generation Beta to come from 2025 to 2039, you know, 15-year span of time. Whether, though, we'll all be over that and Generation Gamma will be picked up after that, that's a bit of an awkward one. Generation Delta may come next. That's a Greek letter we know. But then I think people get a bit vague on their Greek alphabet and it probably all falls apart. But I think the Alpha and probably Generation Beta is here. But, you know, we'll let others and other generations have their voice into that because that's as we move to the middle of this century.
Yeah. And now that that's settled in terms of, you know, why you chose Generation Alpha as the label, I wanted to also just explore briefly how it got pickup and how it got traction. I think it's really interesting. And I know a lot of people have asked us those questions around how do you name a generation? And again, for us, I know that we have been writing about and talking about and putting research out about this generation for the better part of the last decade, even as the youngest or the oldest of them, I should say, were just began being born in 2010. And I recall, you know, some pretty big global international publications like the New York Times and Forbes, you know, picking up that label and slowly more and more people have gotten used to it and use it. So yeah, it's been really cool to see. I think it's really exciting. But do you have anything else to add, Mark, around how, you know, we've been able to communicate that label to people?
Well, I think it's helpful to have a universal descriptor or label that we can use. You know, with Generation Y, which a lot of us here call those in their 30s moving to their 40s, that's useful. But in other parts of the world, they're called millennials. And you know, when you, it leads to confusion. You know, some people say, oh, I'm a millennial. Oh, I'm Generation Y. Well, you know, it's also known as, it's an interchangeable term. But when you have no settling on the name, or for that matter, the years of birth, it gets confusing. And I'm glad that the name has been accepted just for clarity of description. And that the years of birth from 2010 through to 2024, 15 years inclusive, have generally been accepted. And hopefully that 15-year span can continue to allow some unification of years of birth, of description, and of labeling. Until we have an international generational labeling peak body, subgroup of the United Nations or something, until that exists, and I'm sure it won't, you know, at least we can, or hope we can have some agreement on the labeling, because it does make it useful, and we all know what we're talking about. And as we found, Ashley, you know, people do tend to understand what generation they're in now. It's part of one aspect of that connection we have and something of our history and our peer group. So it'll be important for Generation Alpha to know they're part of that generation and that they've got that right around the world as a global generation, that shared language to describe themselves.
Yeah, it's helpful for us talking about them. And it's, like you said, also helpful, for, I think, for them in their own identity and being able to identify with their generation and the peers who they're growing up with. I guess for us, particularly with the Generation Alpha book, what we wanted to do is paint a picture of the world that is shaping this generation and give some language and some examples and some stories from the focus groups that we conducted and different research methodologies like surveys to all inform the world that is shaping them. And there's so many great stories that we were told about for the book. I remember one person relaying to me the story of their little Gen Alpha and how they were just, one day they were sitting in the kitchen or the living room and they just heard their little Gen Alpha child pipe up and say, "Hey Alexa, play Peppa Pig," or "Hey Alexa, play Bluey." And it's this world that they're growing up in with these voice commands. And I've heard even someone say that they'll grow up with these virtual assistants, these personal assistants, in fact, to help them, you know, deal with life and those sorts of things. And there's another great quote. Again, there's just so many, but one that I wanted to read, which is at the beginning of chapter 4 that we've called The Great Screen Age, and it's from a little boy named George who's aged 8 or was aged 8 when we conducted a focus group with some Gen Alphas. And he said, "I love being a kid because when mum was a kid, she didn't have much things to do. And now we have more technology and cool stuff to eat." It's just like so many cute little things from looking at the perspective and the eyes of, you know, through the lens of this generation. And I guess one other thing that we wanted to do is to provide some of these like full page quotes in the book. And I wanted to just read one before I ask you, Mark, about how we can define this generation. And the quote we have is, "When we look back over the long arc of history, there are eras in which society altogether changed. We give them names: the Reformation, the Enlightenment, the Industrial Revolution, post-modernity, and now in the era of Generation Alpha, this digital transformation." And it's such a digitally transformed world that they are shaping. And a lot of people I've interviewed and spoken to when we talk about this generation is, oh, it's technology. It's the digital world that makes them so different to previous generations. But there's more elements to that that we explore in the book. Can you touch and elaborate on some of those defining characteristics that make this generation so different to those in the past?
And screens, as you've said, there are one of those, and probably the most obvious of those. The great screen age, as we've called it, is what is so shaping this generation. And of course, screens have been around for, you know, more than a century. People went to the movies back in the day in the late 1950s. Television came around We've had the PC for 30 or so years, laptops that we can carry around. But in the era of Generation Alpha, it really has been the device, the portable screen. And so screens became ubiquitous from their birth. You know, the iPad was invented and launched the year that Generation Alpha was born, 2010, and all the social media that came with it. And so it has been core to their early entertainment and communications and schooling and just interactions generally. It's the source of information that they largely go to. Books are digital and they consume in a visual sense. And so it has been fully transformative for them. And parents have seen it firsthand and educators are seeing it. And sometimes with questions as well, with concern, because it is having, with the positive impacts, some negatives as well in terms of attention span, in terms of the stimulation, the multi-screening in which they engage, the lack of sometimes creativity to do things that are off-screens. And that quote that you mentioned, you know, of the youngster that we had in the focus group, you know, it really is a mindset that Generation Alpha has. You know, wow, parents, like, how did you even live before screens? Like, what did you even do? Well, we actually did find some things to do. Some of us actually go outdoors and, you know, play. But you know, it is a different era. We understand that. But screens and the need to manage them and have them as tools that can create flourishing in the lives of these children rather than deleterious effects. That's a challenge, but that's a key formative aspect of them. The global connectivity that defines them is so key. And here we are talking about Gen Alpha, not with a Western lens, because the devices, the focus on school retention, the entrepreneurial mindset they bring, the experience of COVID, the empowerment that they have. This is true in the emerging world. It's true on all of the continents. It's not just something of the West. In fact, these days, the popular culture is as likely to be exported from East to West. You think about TikTok, you know, which has come from the East, not the West, and you know, the popular culture, the music, K-pop, Squid Games, you know, doing the rounds on Netflix at the moment, WeChat, you know, so many of the platforms, the influencers, the TikTokers, the social media and YouTubers, it's not just something of the West anymore. So this global connectivity is key, and with that, and probably because of COVID and the impacts economically, just this conservatism that has emerged with Generation Alpha. You know, it's not as though generations get more radical or that they get more demanding or expecting of others to provide for them. Generation Alpha, in their young experience, have seen economic uncertainties, and actually they are seeing the benefit of studying and of then moving into a job that is going to have some security of saving for the rainy day, of being prepared for uncertainty, of being able to roll with the volatility that life presents. Having this experience in their early years is going to have shown to be very formative for them. And so that's a positive. The empowerment that they have is, I think, another key characteristic. Children today have leverage and influence and a voice far more than children of the past. Yes, through social media, through being able to influence the society, through the collectivism they bring there, but also just by being listened to by parents and educators. And that's what we've done a lot. So these focus groups, giving voice to young children and not just telling the world about Generation Alpha, but if you like, being a conduit so we can share the voice that they have and what they think of their world. And that's what we did in the book. So empowered and able to influence and shape their world from a young age. We call them up ages for that reason, because they're older, younger. They've got influence and impact and spend patterns beyond even their own realities. That's something of their world. And it's really unique to this generation. So there's some of the key characteristics that make them such an important and transformative generation.
They are absolutely so empowered. And I really do believe they will be transformative and have transformative impacts. A question I get asked pretty regularly is, we're talking about a generation that is still so young, and the fact that all of them haven't even finished being born yet. We've still got a few more years until that generation will end, and then we'll get Generation Beta to come after them. But how When people ask this question, what's your answer in terms of how can we know so much about this generation even though they are still so young?
Mm. Well, as we said earlier, it all begins when we're young, and what shapes us, therefore, is the home. You know, the home is key. And so we can get a sense of the trajectory of their lives. We can get a sense of what they value and a sense of what is shaping them by looking at their parents and by interviewing their parents. And you and I have done lots of those focus groups of the parents of Generation Alpha and the siblings of them and the extended family. That is going to tell us a lot about them, as well as the educational philosophies and structures that they are moving into and moving through, and the social context, the mores and values of a society. And so we, of course, have studied that and the big impacts, the experiences, the events that leave fingerprints on them are important to understand. And we've discussed COVID and the technology and the globalization and the empowerment of young people. So all of those aspects, what is formative for them in their age, the family unit and beyond, the education, the structures, the technology, the events, the experiences, all of that tells us a lot about them. So even though the bulk of their life is yet to be lived, and the key decisions of their life are yet to be made, and the future is yet to be shaped by them, we can learn a lot about them. We can get now a sense of the trajectory of them. And you've run these focus groups in the US as well as here, Ashley, and so you've seen firsthand how they do have a voice, and you can learn a lot from them and their parents, even though they are so young.
Yeah, I had the real privilege of traveling to the United States at the beginning of 2020, so right before COVID shut all the international borders. So very grateful for that trip. And I was one of the speakers at a conference called Kids Screen Summit. And yeah, I was able to conduct some focus groups in Los Angeles, as well as when we came back, conducting some focus groups with you, Mark, of Australian parents and Australian Gen Alphas. And they really are contributing to the conversation. And I had also the privilege of interviewing a lady named Monica Dreger, who is at the time was the head of global consumer insights at Mattel. So they produce Barbie and Hot Wheels and other toys. And really interesting, one of the quotes that we included from my interview with her in the book is when she said, even though they, talking about Generation Alpha, didn't create the mess that we see in the world today, they're still taking ownership of these issues that they wouldn't have in the past. Activism is part of their mentality of being able to do something about it, even something small. And I think that was really indicative of some of the other insights, other parents and even what we've observed of this generation is that they are speaking up and they're contributing to the conversation and they're finding solutions. And I think that also comes from the fact that they're used to gaming and playing games from such a young age and contributing to the solutions. And so as much as we think we like to know a lot about this generation, we also wanted to give some time in the podcast today to the voice of this next generation. So both you and I have interviewed some of the Gen Alphas in our lives. And so we've got a little snippet of some of their perspective about the world to share.
Okay, Corbin, you're a Gen Alpha. Let me ask you some questions. Firstly, what do you think will be different about the world when you're an adult?
I think it'll be a bit overcrowded, because the population is increasing by a lot.
Okay, and what's one thing that kids know that adults don't know?
How to play Minecraft and how to play other video games.
Fair enough. And why do kids spend so much time on screens, would you say?
I'd say because they've lived their whole life on screen. Like, they've been around screens their whole life.
And what do you do when you feel sad?
I talk to my parents and sometimes play some games.
And what's a job of the future that doesn't yet exist?
I don't know. Maybe like hovercraft fixer, hovercraft mechanic.
Oh, that's good. What's one skill that kids have that adults need to learn?
Probably how to make friends, because if you think when you're an adult, you're making friends but not as many as when you're a kid.
Mm. And if you could change one thing about the world, what would that be?
No more war.
Okay. Well, thanks, Corbin. Good chat.
Okay, Sage, what are you looking forward to most when you get older?
Getting a pet.
What is your favourite thing to do on the weekend?
Go swimming.
Cool. Okay, what do you do when you feel sad?
Go to the swings, but if it's raining, I do painting.
Cool, that's good. What is the most important rule?
Don't drop glass.
How much money do you think you need to buy a house?
1,000.
And if you could change one thing about the world, what would you change?
Bad guys aren't real.
What is one thing that kids know that adults don't know?
How to play.
That's true. I think that too. What is your favourite thing to do on the weekend?
Play Minecraft.
What do you do when you feel sad?
Run away. Have some alone time. Tell my mum and dad about it. And work it out.
Wow, it's very wise of you, Noah. What's the most important rule that you know?
To have fun.
That's a good one. Okay, when you get older, what job would you like to do?
Be a climber, like a rock climber.
Do you think kids your age spend too much time on screens?
Yes and no.
What do you mean?
Some might, some not.
Do you spend too much time on screens?
Yes, sometimes. Then on Minecraft.
Great. So let's continue talking about Generation Alpha and the world shaping them. And of course, we can't really look past this global defining pandemic of COVID-19. And I think what we're seeing in our research and in our observations is that in many ways, the COVID-19 pandemic is and has accelerated some of the trends that we were already seeing. And for Generation Alpha, that looked like virtual schooling and lockdown sort of forcing this generation to spend more time on screens. And that's some of the research that we conducted last year, what we found as well. One of our studies, we asked Australians what sort of impact they think the pandemic will have on the next generation of kids. And 84% of Australians said they agree that COVID will have a significant impact on the next generation of children. And when we delved further into what areas of life they think it's going to impact them, it was around the number one response was that technology and screens will become more integrated into their lives, that they'll expect more flexible working conditions, that education will be delivered more online in the future, and also that as a result, they will be more resilient. So as our research has found, the last 18 months has had some challenges, has had some benefits. There's been some long-term changes to how we work and how we live and how we engage. And that's going to be the same for Gen Alpha. And we've read a lot and we've written a lot about the fact that it's also reinforced this strong connection between Gen Alpha and their parents. They've spent more time at home with their family, so that might change their expectations, these deeper, more enriching experiences with their parents as a result of the pandemic. And I think what it's also shown is that this pandemic has hit in such a formative time in these children's lives, as we've been talking about, and parents have been striving to make the most of that time together. And that's a pretty stark contrast even to Generation Z, who are a bit older, who have also been impacted by the pandemic. But they're dealing with that a little bit more on their own as teenagers and in their early 20s, whereas the impact of COVID has been, I think, on a family context for many of these kids. So we've conducted a lot of research about that. Mark, what do you think about the sort of impact, what sort of impact COVID will have on them now as they're young, but also for their future?
Well, I think it'll show over the long term to have had a positive impact, even though we're very aware of the negative impacts that we're seeing from COVID right now. But you highlighted really well some of the upside of it. You know, pre-COVID, parents were outsourcing so much of the growth of their children. You know, education is outsourced to the professionals, and we understand that. And sport is outsourced to the local sporting club, and a lot of the games and activities are outsourced. People weren't organizing parties. You know, you take them to the local trampoline center or bowling center or whatever. Good, I'll pay the money. You do the party, you know. And we're in an era where you really could sort of pay for the services and outsource so many key aspects of upbringing. But COVID put a stop to that. And suddenly the parents were were co-creators in the education. They were co-educators of them and had to help manage the home front there. Still, the professional teachers had a key role, but parents were seeing more how the education was taking place and supporting their children more. Parents were having to create their own fun. And it was great to see a lot of families bring in games nights and board games got dusted off and grandparents teaching the youngsters how to do cross stitch or little gardens being set up in backyards and these sorts of things. Fantastic, you know. And so there was that family time. There was the rediscovery of shared experiences together. Children had to play at home. They were doing screens all day for education and school. And so in the afternoons, there were non-screen activities that parents were looking to engage the children in. They got to see their parents do work. Work was brought into home. And so they could have that role modeling of seeing parents work and actually of seeing parents work, but also manage the priority of family and dads and not just moms, you know, really active on the childcare in this time. So it had that positive impact. It also meant that children had to be stepping up and taking charge and organizing themselves around their own learning. The spoon feeding model of sitting in a classroom and having it all presented to you suddenly dissipated. And I think that's important, that children take charge of their own learning and education and outcomes. And that was forced upon them. And they did very well. So it created a resiliency. It provided this opportunity where children had to solve problems. They had to roll with the uncertainties day to day, week to week, new public health orders that meant changes, and children responded to that. And children are always resilient. They're at the life stage where they can roll with change, but it forced even more of that upon them. And I think that that ability to innovate and to adapt to the terrain that they're presented with is a great skill that they had developed. It's funny that pre-COVID, schools were running classes in resilience and training in how to be adaptive, how to deal with uncertain times. Well, they got the perfect lesson of that in the real world because of COVID, and that's where we really learn resilience, not in a classroom. So I think there were great positives of that. Now, not everyone did do well through that. And in fact, I saw some Department of Education figures for just New South Wales here where thousands of students who were at school pre-COVID never actually went back to school as school started to go back. They were in maybe the middle teen years and you know, normally we've had been getting close in most states in Australia where 9 in 10 go through to complete year 12. But we suddenly saw a glitch there and a drop off in that, because if they were only being held in education through some really committed teachers and support on the school campus, and suddenly the momentum of that is lost and they're at home and left to their own, a lot just did not zoom in and they just dropped out. And that I think will have some impacts. Kids fell behind with numeracy and literacy. Some of the early indicators there are of that. And it does show something of the benefit of that direct or instructional learning, that real structured delivery that teachers can apply in a classroom that's harder through Zoom. So there's downsides of students being empowered to take charge of their own learning. Not everyone is equally organized and proactive around it. Not every family has the same support structures or skills are there to be able to support the kids. So it's not a universally positive experience, but I think over time it'll show to have produced benefits for this generation and set them up well for a life that is going to have a lot more volatility in its future. And these kids are going to have to learn to continually adapt and find solutions.
Yeah, and that's so true. I think there's some, like anything, there's challenges, but there's also been some benefits. You know, the challenge of not being at school, but then the benefit of having more home time and more time with family and having to get creative. And yeah, shout out to all the parents who are trying to work from home and also, you know, school their kids from home has been a challenge, I think, for many. And I saw one tweet sort of that was really popularized a few months back, when someone said, been homeschooling a 6-year-old and an 8-year-old for 1 hour and 11 minutes. Teachers deserve to make $1 billion a year or a week. And so hopefully something else positive that's come out of the pandemic is that we can really value the great work that the education sector, and particularly teachers, do, and just how important their role is in influencing and shaping the next generation as well. It's been, I think, another challenge for so many because of COVID, and we just chatted through this as well, just around the increased use of screens in kids' lives. And that's certainly been something I have spoken to a lot of parents about around the use of screens, and also, I guess, the tensions that exist with screen use. Some of our research that we conducted found that 90% of parents and 88% of educators agree that children need to be digitally literate to succeed in the future. But also 91% of parents and 95% of educators agree that kids today spend too much time on screens. So I think there's that tension between we know that it's important for the future, but we still recognize the skills that are developed when we're away from screens. And we have written this book for teachers, for leaders, for educators. And when we spoke to a lot of parents, what we also found from our research is that many are experiencing these tensions around, for example, giving children independence, but also wanting to keep them safe. They want to expose them to the real world, but they also want to shelter them and protect them. We want them to engage in formal learning, but we also want them to have play, to have traditional education that worked well, but also participate and learn about the school of life and restrict screen time, but also use it as a reward. So parenting today, as it always has been, is complex, but I think the screens that Generation Alpha are more in front of and earlier than any other generation, even Generation Z, who are incredibly tech savvy in and of their own right, can be a challenge. And for this generation, they're very fluent in the digital world. Talking about Generation Alpha, they're pacified by devices in some cases. And so media consumption and habits like watching YouTube are just a part of their every day. And I know that we've got this saying that the number one search engine for them is no longer Google, it's actually YouTube. Because why would they read something when they can watch it? And so this challenge of screens is complex. Mark, I remember when we were writing the book, you had some really great tips for parents around managing screen time and advice for those of us who find that tension, that challenge. Could you share a little bit about that? I'm sure that'd be really helpful for many people who are parenting and engaging with this emerging generation.
Yeah, sure. And, you know, you've summed up well the dichotomy of raising children or being in a society where we're trying to set these children up for success, and we see the upsides and the downsides. And, you know, parenting is a very nostalgic experience, particularly when the children are young, because you sort of remember your childhood and you want to recreate that for the kids, but you at the same time know it's a different era and they need to have different experiences. And grandparents even more experience that. And that's where sometimes the yearning for the good old days and indeed almost a mourning of the experience young people today have compared to what we had when it was just, you know, a lot simpler is there. But that's not the experience of children. You know, they're excited for these times. They enjoy these times. And I think when we get that balance right, recognizing they're going to need new skills, but also managing these devices so that they can pick up those timeless people skills and traditional skills, that's going to be important. So, yeah, I think we put a little four-step process in place in the book there, and the D of that stage was just to define what we're looking for around screens and to set some of the structures in place so that it doesn't get out of control. And the C was to communicate the values and what we really believe in, what we as a family stand firm on, so that the children can learn what's appropriate, what's not appropriate, so they know the values and have them instilled in them and start to own them, so that they can ensure that they, when they make their own decisions, are on that good and shared value platform. And the B was the behavioral. You know, we've got to give children behavioral skills so that they can manage those screen urges, so that they are set up with, if you like, some resources, internal resources, so that they know, I know I'm spending too long on this, so what's my pattern? Okay, I set time, or I put limits on, or I've self-disciplined with my schedule, or we develop those behavioral skills so that they can manage that. And the A was just accountability, that parents ultimately have this important responsibility of raising children, and they're accountable for what the children get up to and for how the children are spending their time. The parents own the devices. The parents pay for those internet bills. It's ultimately their contract and their account. And if some tough love is needed, and it is love, that's why it's called tough love, but it's sometimes got that disciplinary edge to it, which requires the parents to say, all right, we're going to have a screen-free day. Or because of that, you stepped over that line we agreed to, no screens this weekend, locking up the devices perhaps, or turning off the internet. You know, it does come with with temporary consequences of a lot of tears and tantrums, but those responses are temporary and symptoms do pass. So keep that in mind, parents. And the children, while at the time, and I've experienced this many times firsthand as a parent, feel the angst of the children and the wrath, you know, because we're taking the screen away. They are actually grateful because within a short period of time, they find some other activity. They're getting away from the intensity of the screens, which does put them in a certain mood. And they breathe a little and get involved in another creative activity or play with a sibling or go outside. That time in nature is so important. And then they're actually secretly glad for it. They're happy to have the device back when their time has passed. But they're secretly glad for parents who see the bigger picture and who love them and care for them and put boundaries in place and can reinforce those boundaries in a loving and supportive way. So having some structures as parents is important. It's not battle over. It's not lost. Yes, the kids know the technology more than we do, but we have a history, a perspective and life experience that they don't have. And when parents step up and put technology into its positive context, it makes all the difference for the kids.
That's such profound and wise advice, and I'm sure many parents and teachers and leaders and aunties and uncles really appreciate that. So thank you, Mark. I want to talk now just to sort of end the podcast about the future for this generation, because when we were conducting research for the Generation Alpha book, I was quite surprised by how many people said they were scared for this generation's future. And many believe that we are growing up in a time, and they're growing up in a time of increasing complexity and uncertainty with greater societal, economic, and social volatility. And that is true. But that therefore leads many people, I've found, to have this perspective that it's a terrible future that lies ahead for this generation of kids. And so it might come as a surprise to many listeners today that we actually believe the outlook for Generation Alpha is positive. There's a bright hope for their future. And even though they will face some challenges around screens and like the other challenges other young generations have had, like bullying and online bullying and mental health and the social pressure to be a high achiever, this is some of the pressures that we know from our research parents today think the next generation are going to face, that they are a generation with great opportunity and capability. And even though people fear the future they will inherit, we don't actually have to have that outlook. And my question for you, Mark, is the outlook for this generation really that bad? And what do they have to look forward to?
Well, all you need to do if we're feeling glass half empty, if we're feeling a bit pessimistic about the future, is spend some time looking through the lens of kids. Just observe kids because kids give us all a spark in life because they are optimistic by life stage. They generally are creative in approach. They're solution-minded. They're adaptive to the environment that you put in. And they, like any young thing, flora or fauna, they grow. They're at the growing, flourishing stage of life. And so that gives us optimism, just looking at them responding to what has been the toughest time in, as adults, surely, our living memory. Look at how they've rolled on and found humor and found connection in what has been the most isolating time, probably of the last century. And that gives us hope. They get excited about sometimes the little things in life. We can lose our sense of awe and our sense of the delight in the simple. We overcomplicate life. We skip through it. We focus on the end game and we miss the journey. Kids don't do that. And so I guess my encouragement, if we're feeling less than optimistic, is look into the eyes of kids, look through the eyes of kids, observe them a little bit and see the vibrancy, the zest for life that they bring. And they're just squeezing a lot of it out of life and making a great go of it. These are the only times they've ever known. And they wouldn't want to exchange these times for our times. They wouldn't want to exchange their life stage for our life stage. They're excited to be living in this amazing world at this amazing time and at their amazing young age with the future ahead of them, and they will shape a bright future, no question about it. So let's give them a little bit more confidence and positivity than sometimes, you know, the negative skepticism we bring. And I think give them the space, give them the support, give them the direction, give them our wisdom, but also give them some tools and some solutions so that they can create their own future. And I think the future will be bright that Generation Alpha will shape.
And there is something so powerful, you're so right, about just speaking to them and hearing their perspective. And even though it's not fully formed yet and it's funny at times, you know, it is an amazing perspective to look through the eyes of a child at the future. And I think, as you shared earlier, we've often asked many young people, is there any other time that you'd rather be alive? And a lot of them say, no, now's great. And so it's amazing. And I wanted to just read one more funny quote from the Gen Alpha book from one of the focus groups we conducted, from a boy named Jaden, aged 8, who said, "I'll go to university, travel, find someone to marry and have kids and then get a job. I want to be a race car driver and I wanted to be Spider-Man, but I know I can't." And it's just those funny little outlooks they have around the future and their hopes and their dreams. And, yeah, there is some great optimism that we have for them. And I know, Mark, you and I always feel a bit weird sort of quoting your own book, but I've done it already a few times in the episode, and I'm just going to end on reading out the final paragraph from our Generation Alpha book, which says, "Generation Alpha are being shaped in different times to generations past. They're more digital, global, mobile, social, and visual than any generation before them. There's no doubt that Generation Alpha will come up against their challenges, their own storm clouds and uncertainty. We've touched on some of those challenges and uncertainties in this book. Others we haven't had the insight to forecast, but one thing is certain to us. Their future is bright. And like every other generation, they will find the tools they need to thrive in it. The future for Generation Alpha is exciting, full of creativity, innovation, and opportunity. They're not only following the positive examples set by older generations, but they're also empowered to take action, stand up for what they believe in, and pave a new way forward. And it's here that we want to leave you with the anticipation of a great future for Generation Alpha, with the thrill of the new, the thrill of hope." So it's our hope that this book and this podcast and the resources we've put out are a real encouragement and help people and leaders who are engaging with the next generation to feel equipped and feel empowered to help them thrive in the future.
Yeah, so true. Well read, and can I say well written as well? You know, there would be no children if we didn't believe in the future. And yet we've got more children in our society today and in our world than ever before. And that in itself is a vote of confidence in the future. And I think these children won't let us down. They will shape that great investment and trust we've put in their hands as the emerging generation and bring about great outcomes into the future that they shape. I think history will show that to be the case with Generation Alpha.
Absolutely. Well, thank you, Mark. Thank you for the great chat, and thank you for giving them that name and for your time on the podcast today.
Oh, you're welcome. Thanks, Ash.
And if anyone is interested in finding out more about the Generation Alpha book that we've been talking about in the podcast or some of the insights that we shared today, you can head to a website that we run called www.generationalpha.com. We've got lots of free resources available to you there. And looking ahead, I'm really excited because we've got some really great episodes planned, some new guests coming up, and I can't wait to explore some of those topics and those insights that we've got. So for more insights about the future, you can subscribe to our podcast. You can watch the video recording of these podcasts on YouTube. Visit McCrindle.com.au or follow us on socials. So thanks so much for listening. Bye.